Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from Mario Ritter Jr., Andrew Smith, and Jill Robbins. Then Brian Lynn presents this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Finally, Andrew and Jill return to present the lesson of the day. But first,
American company Boeing will admit to criminal charges of wrongdoing linked to two deadly passenger jet crashes. The aerospace manufacturer will also pay a fine of $243.6 million. The U.S. Department of Justice said late Sunday that the company had violated an agreement that had protected it from legal action for 3 years. The two crashes of Boeing 737 MAX airliners killed 346 people in a five-month period from 2018 to 2019. Government lawyers gave Boeing the choice of entering a guilty plea and paying the fine or facing a trial. If the trial had taken place, Boeing would have faced felony charges of criminal conspiracy to defraud the United States. The government, which approved the airplane and the pilot training required for it, charged Boeing with lying. A federal judge still must approve the deal before it can go into effect. In addition to the plea and fine, the government will name an independent monitor to supervise Boeing's safety and quality methods for 3 years. The company must also spend at least $455 million on compliance and safety programs. The deal only covers the wrongdoing by Boeing before the crashes. The Justice Department said it does not protect Boeing from recent dangerous incidents in which, for example, a panel of a plane came off during an Alaska Airlines flight in January. The deal only affects the company and not current or former Boeing officials. The company confirmed it had reached a deal with the government but had no other comment. The complete written agreement is expected to be presented to the federal court by July 19th. Families for some of the people who died on the flights criticized the deal. Paul Cassell is a lawyer for some of the families. He said, "This sweetheart deal fails to recognize that because of Boeing's conspiracy, 346 people died. A group of the families is asking the government to seek a fine of nearly $25 billion. The company's guilty plea will be entered in a U.S. district court in the southwestern state of Texas. Judge Reed O'Connor has called Boeing's behavior egregious criminal conduct. The case involves two crashes. One took place in Indonesia and the other in Ethiopia. Investigators said the pilots in the Lion Air crash did not know about flight control software that would affect control of the airplane. The pilots of the Ethiopian Airlines crash knew about the software, but were still unable to control the plane. The software is called the Maneuvering Characteristics Augmentation System. Boeing designed it to cause the airplane's nose to point down under a certain set of flight conditions. The software aimed to save money by reducing the amount of training time pilots needed to use the system. The software is used in 737 MAX airplanes and did not exist on earlier aircraft. The Justice Department charged Boeing in 2021 with lying to Federal Aviation Administration officials about the software. Under a deal at the time, the government did not bring charges if the company paid a $2.5 billion settlement, which included a fine of $243.6 million. Boeing was also required to meet the requirements of anti-fraud laws for 3 years. Boeing blamed two low-level employees for misleading government officials. The government charged a former company official. In 2022, a jury found a former Boeing chief technical pilot not guilty in connection with the company's wrongdoing. After the crashes, the government grounded or halted all flights of the 737 MAX airplanes involved for about 20 months. Boeing is based in Arlington, Virginia, although the 737 MAX aircraft are built in the state of Washington. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Scientists studying the spread of bird flu in the United States say they worry about a lack of data in tracking the virus called type A H5N1. In recent months, the disease has spread to 129 groups of cows across 12 states. Experts have identified the disease in other mammals as well, from alpacas to house cats. The scientists are concerned about rising cases among cows. They say the increase probably means the virus has been changing. They say such changes could make it easier for the virus to spread from animals to humans. 3 people in the U.S. have tested positive for H5N1 bird flu since late March after being in close contact with cows. Scott Hensley is a professor of microbiology at the University of Pennsylvania. He said the threat of a pandemic is currently low, but could rise quickly. Health officials say the earlier they know about cases of human infection, the sooner they can take steps to reduce its spread.
The U.S. government tests cows for the virus. However, those tests are currently limited to cows crossing state borders. Government health officials and pandemic flu experts told Reuters news agency, there is very little testing of people who come into contact with sick cattle. Human and animal health agencies sometimes differ in the ways they deal with the flu. Experts say these differences could make it harder to respond quickly to an outbreak. Still, a U.S. Department of Agriculture spokesperson said the agency is working around the clock with the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, CDC, in a whole-of-government response. The spokesperson added that research shows America's food supply remains safe. Sick cows generally recover after a few weeks, and the risk to human health remains low.
Some pandemics, including COVID-19, arrive with little warning. In the last flu pandemic caused by H1N1 in 2009, the virus had first spread among animals for several years, Hensley said. But he added that more tracking of the virus would have helped health officials prepare. The CDC estimates that between about 150,000 and 500,000 people died worldwide during the 2009 pandemic. The World Health Organization, or WHO, says there is no evidence of H5N1 spreading from human to human. For that reason, the WHO says the risk to humans is currently low. Wenqing Zhang is the head of the WHO's Global Influenza Preparedness Agency. She said health organizations have ways to launch large production of tests, treatments, and vaccines if needed.
The Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, or CEPI, is a nonprofit based in Oslo, Norway. The organization works to develop vaccines and other ways to fight against pandemics. CEPI aims to create a collection of vaccines for viruses that could cause pandemics. This would help drug makers start large production and deliver the medicine where necessary within 100 days of an outbreak. Some countries are taking steps to protect people against H5N1. The U.S. and Europe are gathering pre-pandemic flu vaccine that could be used for high-risk groups, including farm or lab workers.
Zhang of the WHO said expanding vaccines to more people is complex. Makers of pandemic flu vaccines make seasonal flu shots and cannot produce both at once, she said. Most flu vaccines are made using virus grown in eggs. That means it could take up to 6 months to produce pandemic shots. However, mRNA vaccines can be produced more quickly. On July 2nd, the U.S. government gave $176 million to drug maker Moderna to finish development and testing of their mRNA vaccine against H5N1. Experts also say there is a need to balance quick action against reacting too strongly to virus threats. Wendy Barkla is a virologist at Imperial College London. She also advises the UK Health Security Agency on bird flu. She said health officials want to give warnings without saying the world is about to end. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
Experienced gardeners have likely learned to look out for poison ivy, a common plant found across North America, Europe, and East Asia. While this green leafy plant is not life-threatening, it can cause severe skin reactions in many people. Associated Press gardening writer Jessica Damiano recently wrote that while she personally has not had any bad experiences with poison ivy, many gardeners she knows have. So, in an effort to help gardeners, or people who simply enjoy spending time outdoors, deal with this plant, Damiano has come up with some suggestions for how to find and safely get rid of it. The official name for poison ivy is Toxicodendron radicans. The plant contains oily chemical compounds called urushiols in its leaves, stems, and roots. The American Skin Association estimates about 85% of the U.S. population is allergic to urushiols. Of those, between 10 to 15% are considered highly allergic. The group says this makes the plant concerning and possibly dangerous for about 50 million Americans affected each year. Damiano writes that this means poison ivy should be removed from gardens in most cases. But that can be tricky. Touching the plant to remove it can harm those involved. Identifying poison ivy plants can be difficult. This is partly because the plant takes on different appearances at different times of the year. Most often, however, its leaves are made up of three leaflets each. The middle stem is longer than the stems of the side leaflets. Young leaves usually appear shiny, while older leaves do not. Larger, older vines, especially those climbing up trees, are hairy. Leaf color can be green, red, pink-tinged, yellow, or orange. Some leaf ends are smooth, while others have toothed edges. Damiano admitted that even she has trouble spotting poison ivy. She has misidentified the plant in the past. She said some people might want to seek advice from a poison ivy expert or do research online. Local agriculture organizations can also be helpful in confirming a poison ivy identification. When dealing with poison ivy, people should wear protective clothing for their hands, arms, legs, and eyes. Avoid touching anything in the process, especially the face. Remember, the plant can pass on its poison through clothing or tools. The best way to completely remove poison ivy is to pull it up by its roots. For gardeners living in a four-season area, the job will be easiest in early spring, when the ground is softer. The main roots of the plant can grow down about 30 centimeters, and runner roots can spread outward in lengths up to 6 meters. Both of these root systems must be removed to avoid future growth. All parts of the poison ivy plant must be effectively removed. This material should be placed in a tightly sealed, heavy black plastic bag and set out for waste removal. Poison ivy should never be burned. That is because the smoke is known to contain harmful substances that could be deadly if breathed in. After completing removal operations, do not touch anything. The plant's poisons can remain. First, wash your hands with one of several specialty products made to completely remove all poisons from the plant. Avoid using your normal soap because these can spread the plant's oils to other parts of the body. After removing all clothes, take a shower with the same specialty cleanser. I'm Brian Lynn. Thank you.
Brian Lynn joins me now to talk more about his health and lifestyle report. Hi, Brian. Thanks for being here.
Of course. Thank you for having me.
This week, your report gave some helpful tips for dealing with a plant many people try very hard to avoid, poison ivy. The report points out that about 85% of Americans are allergic to the chemicals found in poison ivy. Are you one of them?
Actually, I have to say yes, and I have been affected quite a bit by poison ivy in my own life. As a child, we lived near wooded areas with large amounts of this plant, and before I knew any better, I would have terrible allergic reactions after just playing in areas where poison ivy was among other vegetation. Then as an adult, I was exposed to the plant while doing gardening work. In these situations, my big mistake was working without gloves, and I would be pulling out roots from multiple plants in the dirt, some of which belonged to poison ivy. How about you? Have you had personal experiences with this plant?
I have dealt with poison ivy, but I've never had a really strong reaction. What would you say is the main takeaway of your report this week?
I do think perhaps the best advice given in this report is when trying to get rid of poison ivy, do not touch other parts of the body until you are sure there is no trace of these chemicals on your hands. Because this was once a problem for me as well, I must have touched my face, which then turned into a very swollen, itchy patch around my eye. Not fun, but surely it taught me a lesson.
All right. Thanks so much for being here, Brian, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello! My name is Anna Mateo.
Today's lesson talks about the verbs hope and wish. Wish and hope are similar, but we generally say the word wish when we think it is unlikely that we can or will do something.
So if I say, I hope I can finish my homework by tomorrow, that means I'm not sure I can finish it. But it also means I think I might be able to finish on time.
But if I say, I wish I could finish my homework by tomorrow, that means I do not think it is possible for me to finish on time. And by saying wish, I express the idea that I want a situation that is different from my real situation.
Andrew, is there something you cannot do but wish you could do?
That's a good question. I think I'm pretty happy with what I can do, but I wish I could speak more languages. I think I would like to speak Chinese. How about you, Jill?
I wish I could go scuba diving. I have a certification, but I don't have the chance to go to a place to dive nowadays. Now, let's listen to Anna in Lesson 10 of Level 2 of Let's Learn English. She is talking on the phone with her friend, Bruna. Be sure to listen for the verbs hope and wish.
Hi, Anna.
Hi, Bruna. What's up?
I thought we could meet for lunch today.
I wish I could, but I can't. I have to research Peru for a story.
How's it going?
Not so good. I've been reading about Peru and listening to Peruvian music. I really want to understand Peru. I hope it's enough.
You should visit Peru.
I wish.
You can.
Bruna, I don't have the money or time to go to Peru. My deadline is tomorrow.
No, I don't mean to really go there. The museum where I work is having a Peruvian festival today.
Anna? Anna? Anna, are you there?
At that last part, Anna got so excited when she heard about the festival that she just left her office and forgot to say goodbye on the phone. Now, let's talk more about the verb wish. We wish for things we cannot do, be, or have at the present time. That's why, when Bruna asked Anna to go to lunch, Anna said,
I wish I could, but I can't. I have to research Peru for a story.
For things we cannot do, but wish to do, we add the modal could after the word wish. Listen to these three examples.
I wish I could speak Chinese. I wish I could visit my family more often. I wish I could save more money.
In those three examples, the speaker cannot speak Chinese, cannot visit family, and cannot save money. But the speaker wishes he could do those things.
Next, for things we do not or cannot have, we put the word had after the word wish. Listen to these examples. We'll say what we don't have and then what we wish for.
I don't have much time.
I wish I had more time.
I don't have many friends.
I wish I had more friends.
Next, for situations or states of being, we change the form of the verb be. After the word wish, we say were. Listen to these examples. We'll describe a situation and then say the different situation we wish for. I am not young.
I wish I were younger.
It is not sunny today.
I wish it were sunny today.
You are not here with me.
I wish you were here with me.
Now, here's one more example with Bruna and Anna. They meet at the museum. Listen for the verbs hope and wish.
Don't forget, this festival also shows Peruvian art.
I hope I have time to see everything.
Anna, I wish I could join you, but I have some work to do.
Of course, of course. You go back to work. I'll check out the art.
Andrew, I wish we had more time to give our listeners ways to practice using the verb wish.
Me too, but don't worry. In our next lesson of the day, we're going to explain more and give our listeners ways they can practice using the verb wish.
I hope they will listen to that lesson.
Me too. And we hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. Remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.